Good evening, 158. It's State Representative Christina Sappey. Thank you so much for joining us for a conversation about transportation in Pennsylvania this evening. I'm so excited to have with us this evening our new Secretary of Transportation and my former colleague in the House, Mike Carroll, join us. Thank you for joining us tonight, Secretary.
Thank you.
We have also with us some of our executives from PennDOT District 6 who know this area really well. So we're looking forward to taking your questions tonight. We'll be talking a lot about the history of, you know, the things that have occurred over the last several decades to get us to where we are here, transportation-wise and infrastructure-wise in Pennsylvania. We're also going to talk about our vision for Pennsylvania infrastructure going forward and how we think things are going to shape up in this next budget, which is we're heading into next week. We're going to start the month of June working on the budget. So we have a lot to talk about there. We have a lot of questions that have already been submitted to us. If you have a question that you have not yet submitted and you'd like to have the secretary or myself answer your question tonight, please email repsappy@pahouse.net and we will try to get to your question. If we don't get to every question tonight, we will follow up with you either through the office or the secretary or PennDOT 6 will get back to you, but you will hear from us. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Secretary Carroll to tell us a little bit about what's going on at PennDOT.
Thank you so much, Representative Sappey, and good evening, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be with all of you tonight in a virtual town meeting. And first, congratulations to you, Representative Sappey, for leading this. There's nothing more American than a town meeting. The founding of the United States and New England and here in Pennsylvania and Delaware, town meetings were how people organized their government and how they advanced the interests of the community to their government leaders. And so this is the essence of governance, not just in Chester County, but in Pennsylvania and really the United States. So kudos to you for hosting this tonight. I know it's not your first one. I will just give a little background on myself for all of you that as Chris said, I had a chance to serve in the House with her. I predated her service in the House by a few years. I served in the House for 16 years, starting in 2007, and served the district in northeastern Pennsylvania in Luzerne and Lackawanna counties, right between Scranton and Wilkes-Barre. And during my service in the House, I focused on transportation issues. I had a career at PennDOT during the Casey administration prior to my election to the House. And so I had focused on transportation issues during my career. And then I had the high honor of serving as the Democratic chair of the Transportation Committee in the House for the final two terms of my tenure. And I chose not to run last year. And then I had the high honor of being selected by Governor Shapiro to be the Transportation Secretary, and the equally high honor of being confirmed by the Senate 49-0 a couple of weeks ago, one absentee member, but that's okay. You know, there's no perfection in this world. And so I have the opportunity to lead a large agency across all 67 counties. What I would tell you is that when it comes to PennDOT, we intersect with the lives of 13 million people every single day. And that's a real tall responsibility to satisfy 13 million people every day at 100% clip is what we aim for. But it's hard to achieve that because perfection is the goal, but seldom delivered. But we try. And the good news is that we have really exceptional people in PennDOT in all 67 counties, including Chester County, that try their best to meet the needs of the 13 million folks in our state and those that travel through our state. So I don't want to monopolize and filibuster the time here. We'll get to the questions. After having served in the House for 16 years, I thoroughly enjoy the back and forth. Based on the technology that we're using tonight, I don't know that we'll have back and forth, but I will be sincere and try and be honest. When I served in the House, I tried to set expectations with folks in a way that, I didn't blow smoke in a way that, to make them think something was going to happen that never could happen. So I'll try and be as sincere and honest as I can be. If there's a question that I can't, respond to right off the top of my head, we'll either lean on the District 6 people who are with me on this meeting, or we'll get back to you with some more detail instead of just giving you the brush off with the question. So I'll stop there. And again, thank all of you for participating tonight. It's really nice to see so many folks involved.
Thank you so much, Mike. Could you tell us a little bit, for especially for the residents that are on the call that may not be familiar with Act 89 and how we've been, funding infrastructure and transportation in Pennsylvania and where we are now? Is that possible?
Sure. Maybe we'll start with some PennDOT 101 for everybody. Because you have to remember, transportation is not just roads and bridges. There are many modes of transportation. You're all familiar with the Port of Philadelphia, not far from where you are. You're definitely familiar with the Philadelphia Airport. You have SEPTA that serves this county. So I just rattled off aviation, the ports, and transit. We have railroads, plenty of railroad news in the last few months. We have bicycles and pedestrians. And so we have, and I'm probably missing one, but we have many, many modes of transportation. What you need to know about transportation is when it comes to roads and bridges, just roads and bridges, that is funded with the motor license fund. That is the money that is collected by PennDOT from gasoline and diesel taxes, as well as driver license and vehicle registration fees. That money goes into a dedicated fund, constitutionally protected mostly, and we'll get to that. And that money can be used for roads and bridges only. It cannot be used for the Port of Philadelphia. It cannot be used for the Philadelphia Airport. It can't be used for SEPTA. And the challenge we have when it comes to funding transportation, most people, especially outside of the urban and suburban PA, don't consider the other modes very much. If you live in rural Pennsylvania or north central Pennsylvania, roads and bridges is where it's at for you. So the challenge we have is when it comes time to fund transportation, you have to reconcile the need to do roads and bridges, which is gasoline, diesel taxes, driver license, motor vehicle fees, and just for the sake of the conversation, transit. And transit gets funded out of the general fund, the fund that is part of the Commonwealth's budget that does human services and state police and Department of Corrections and so on. So that's the challenge for us in terms of trying to figure out a way to fund roads and bridges and transit. The other challenge with Pennsylvania, for a little context, is when you hear often, and may come up tonight, we have the highest gas tax or second highest gas tax in the nation. How could this be? How could the roads be so poor? What I would offer is that Pennsylvania uniquely has more miles of road than the New York, New Jersey, and all the New England state DOTs combined. And that is a function of the fact that Pennsylvania has in our state highway network what are called SRs, four-digit roads. They're in every county, including Chester, and in other states, those SRs would either be county roads or local roads. So PennDOT has 44,000 miles of roads and 25,000 bridges, and so we have to maintain a network much, much larger than almost any other state DOT near. The only other ones that have a comparable system is California and Texas because of the size of those states. So we have this huge network. And we have the reliance on the gas tax and driver license motor vehicle fees. And then what I'll end with is that when it comes to the money that we collect with gas tax and the driver license motor vehicle fees, PennDOT, because of budgeting that was done going backwards in time, supports the state police budget. So we take out of the bar motor license fund, the money for roads and bridges, currently $500 million a year to help fund the state police. $500 million a year is a lot of money, and it's hard for somebody to comprehend what that means. But I will tell you this, $500 million is about 8 cents a gallon on the gas tax. So when you pay 60 cents gas tax in Pennsylvania, 8 cents of that goes to the state police. Another 8 cents goes to local governments with their liquid fuel allocation. So we take 8 cents off the top for the state police. We take 8 cents off the top for local governments. And then there's two or three other pennies for the turnpike and some other odds and ends, Department of Revenue for gasoline testing and such. So when it's all said and done, we're taking about 20 cents a gallon off the gas tax. And so all of a sudden, our highest or second highest gas tax in the nation isn't the highest anymore. And we still have the 44,000 mile roads to maintain. So the comparison of Pennsylvania's gas tax to New Jersey, I often say, is apples to watermelons. It's just the responsibilities are different, and it's just not fair to compare the two states because the responsibilities are different. That's PennDOT 101 when it comes to transportation and funding. And when it comes to any of the questions that I expect to get, the common denominator will be, how are we going to pay for this stuff? And that is the biggest challenge of all.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that explanation. I think that's so important for people to understand, that this is a real funding challenge because we're trying to, pay for so much out of that. So thank you for explaining that. Could you go over, before we get into some other questions, could you also go over what we're hoping for in this budget? And that's, again, what's been proposed. It's not a done deal until June 30th, hopefully.
So the governor and Governor Shapiro is, of course, a strong advocate for all modes of transportation, roads and bridges included, transit, all the others. When it comes to roads and bridge budget, the governor is proposing, and I fully support, the preservation of $100 million of the $500 that we currently give to the state police. So instead of giving the state police $500 million for the fiscal year that would start on July 1st, we would give them $400 million. And hold back $100 million to put with our program for road and bridge projects across the state. And the governor proposes we do that $100 million each year for the next 5 years, so we get the motor license fund held harmless, and the state police get fully funded out of the general fund. Commonwealth's financial position is in a state that the general fund can certainly afford to make up $100 million that's being requested this year. The state police do not get any kind of a reduction in their allocation. They get fully funded. I know some communities in Chester County rely on the state police for local coverage, as in almost every other county. And so the governor has no appetite or interest in reducing the amount of money available for the state police. The sweet spot that we're going for is fully fund the state police with only $400 million for the motor license fund this year. And that $100 million helps PennDOT provide some match money that we need for the federal bill that was passed or signed by President Biden in 2021, the BIL bill. So we need money for the match on some of those dollars.
And that's a beautiful segue to the federal infrastructure. And this is going to be my last question before we move into our residents' questions. But the infrastructure bill that was passed in Washington, I think a lot of folks, have had the perception that a lot of that money we were going to see here locally. Could you sort of explain how we're going to see that in our area, in the region, in Southeast? What is that going to look like?
So the federal bill, like the different modes that I described a minute ago, when it comes to roads and bridges, the federal bill provides about $700 million a year for PennDOT, equally split between roads and bridges. I'm rounding the numbers a little bit, but it's close to that. And so, again, $700 million, what does that mean? What kind of context do we use? When it comes to PennDOT's program, the list of projects that we're going to do in a year, we've always been in the, $2.2, $2.3 billion range. The federal money puts us in the $2.8, $2.9 billion range. And so that extra money is desperately needed, and we're thrilled to get it. And I know, like you, when I served in the House, a lot of people, would say something like, well, now that the federal government finally passed the transportation bill, all of our problems are solved. And sadly, I would have voted for that bill if I were in Congress. But the reality is we need more help. And so, that's not likely to happen in the short term in Congress. I think they did their transportation bill, and that's what we're going to have for a while. But it doesn't solve all of our problems. And again, the transportation bill that Congress passed provides money for aviation. It provides money for transit. It provides money for the Port of Philadelphia. But those dollars are siloed, so they could only go to that particular mode. So the $700 million that we get for the entire state for roads and bridges is only for roads and bridges.
Okay. And so if we're putting that towards roads and bridges, does that free up any PennDOT dollars or any dollars in the general fund for municipal work?
No, the PennDOT, our program is the motor license fund.
Okay.
And so the motor license fund is augmented with the federal money. And so the money that would go out of the general fund for, Keystone Communities or Elm Street or any of the other appropriations that are directed to municipal governments would not be affected by the money that we get from the federal government with respect to roads and bridges.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying that for me. All right. Well, I think now I'm going to introduce Dan Bixler, who's going to help us field some of these questions. And hi, Dan, how are you?
Hi, good, good. Well, thank you for holding this virtual town hall, State Representative Christina Sappey, and thanks for being with us today, Secretary Carroll. For those of you following along at home, I want to remind you that you can ask your questions by submitting them via email to repsappey@pahouse.net. That's REPSAPPEY at pahouse.net. But let's get right into our first question then from the folks at home. One of your constituents asks, does PennDOT have any say on state police coverage for speed enforcement? How can we reduce speeding on highways and especially our rural roads?
Okay, so that's a tough one for PennDOT because, of course, there are no PennDOT police. We do not write citations. There are state police and local police officers that enforce the vehicle code, which is the Title 75 is the consolidated statutes that speak to rules of the road generally, including speeding. One thing the PennDOT does do is provide grant funds to the state police for speed enforcement in high traffic areas, high accident areas. But the challenge that the questioner brings forward is real. The challenge of speed enforcement in rural areas is difficult for local police officers. Pennsylvania is the only state in the nation that does not have radar for local police. The state police coverage that is required in townships and boroughs that don't have a local police department, the state police is spread thin. Now, Governor Shapiro and his budget request adds money for additional state police cadets and new classes to enhance the ranks of our state police. But not to filibuster the answer, but there are no PennDOT police, and so PennDOT's not writing citations when it comes to speeding. We do have some nuanced enforcement effects or efforts with respect to truck weight and truck enforcement. You might see those folks in rest stops and such, where we're weighing trucks or we're checking the brakes and the tires on trucks. But when it comes to speeding, we do not.
All right, great.
Dan, I'm so sorry. I have to jump in here just because speeding is something that we hear about every single day. And absolutely. I experience, you know, I'm getting passed on, you know, unpainted state roads, local roads, you know, that are really, really narrow. And Mike, you know what these roads are like. They're really narrow country roads with no shoulder. In some cases, they have the banks that come up. And I'm asking this as a legislator, do you think there's an opportunity through legislation to permit our, you know, local law enforcement to use radar in a PSP covered area?
First part is that the radar for local police bill has been introduced in the House. I don't know who the sponsor is, but it's a bill that it enjoys broad support, but we were never able during my time in the House to get it to the finish line for a myriad of reasons. A lot of the conservative folks have concerns about it being used to just be a money raiser for some townships. So do I think there's a path for radar for local police? Yes, I think somewhere along the way, Pennsylvania will have radar for local police. The second part of your question, I'm not quite grasping. So if the municipality has the local police department, then they'll be able to use radar if we change the law.
Right.
If they don't have a local police department and rely on the state police already have access to radar. Thereafter, they would like authorization for something called LIDAR, which is radar that would allow the opposite direction. But so radar for local police, I think really it would be a giant step in the right direction. If nothing else, it would at least give motorists a little bit more pause for, with respect to speeding.
Mm-hmm. Let me try to clarify. In our area, in so much of my district, we are covered by state police. We have a few local, law enforcement agencies, but, you know, just a couple. So if, let's say you're in a township that's covered by PSP, you know, would we, if we, you know, had some police officer driving through with radar, it's not his jurisdiction per se, you know, could we legislate that he would be allowed to enforce speed in a PSP covered area?
If you change the law to do that, yes, of course you can. There would be 101 questions that members would have, I'm sure.
Right.
And like any other legislative effort, building consensus is time consuming and sometimes challenging because the diversity in the state for folks from Chester County is real. Mm-hmm. And what I mean is political diversity. Diversity in terms of rural versus suburban versus urban. There are wild differences between Philadelphia County and Potter County in North Central PA.
Exactly.
We have a county in this state, Sullivan County, with 5,000 people in the entire county. And so to reconcile the political desires of people in Sullivan County, very rural, small population and the urban centers that you're familiar with in Southeast PA, it's a real challenge. It's why it's hard to govern in Pennsylvania. Everybody says purple state and all of that. But the reality of it is that there's wild diversity in the state between the rural and sort of the urban suburban areas.
Thank you for saying that, because I say that, you know, when I'm out in, you know, local government meetings and when I'm talking with constituents all the time. This is a huge state with very diverse needs, but speeding is one of our biggest problems here in a rural area, and the number of accidents that our fire departments are responding to are far more than the fires they're going to at this point. So, all right, I'm going to let Dan get to more questions. Thank you so much for putting up with me there.
No, it's all good.
No worries. The next question here is from one of the neighbors in the 158th district, and it says, how does PennDOT prioritize which roadways get repaired?
So the word repaired is going to have multiple definitions. I mean, if we're talking about a repair would mean, milling of the road and resurfacing the road, are we talking about oil and chip? Are we talking about pothole repair? So I guess what I would say when it comes to pothole repair triage, you know, we repair them as we come to know about them or as we see them for ourselves. When it comes to a more sophisticated repair, for example, resurfacing of a road, that would be part of PennDOT's maintenance program. Each county has an index which keeps track of the rideability of the road and the state of the asphalt that's providing the wearing course. So repair, Dan, makes it a little hard because it's a little nebulous in terms of how you define repair. I know this, when we preserve $100 million in our state police funding that I talked about earlier, a portion of that will go to county maintenance operations, and a portion of it will go to the program for new construction or major maintenance projects like the resurfacing of Route 1, for example. So the maintenance is as important as the 420 bridge that we broke ground on today in Delaware County. But maintenance would get you to probably what the questioner is asking about, you know, basic repair, shoulder cutting, vegetation control, pothole patching, the things that you would expect need to be done on a continuing basis to make sure that that we're providing an asset that is safe and serves the needs of the community. And all of it is reconciled with the challenges of a budget that there's just not enough money, and there's probably not enough men and women working for PennDOT to meet every single need that I would like to meet. Unlimited money and unlimited staff would be wonderful, but we all know that we do not live in that world.
All right, great. And just kind of a follow-up to that then, what takes so long for bridge projects to get through planning and ultimately repair? This person cites Embryville took over a year from damage for construction to begin. What takes so long to get things going?
The reality is that the permitting process and the design process are not done overnight. When we're going to replace a bridge, you have to design it in a way that it meets the needs of the community. It recognizes, the topography and the wetlands and the historic features that might be nearby. And so we don't just take down a bridge and throw another one up and call it a day and try and get it done, in a month and a half. There's a lot more to it than that, and design and also just the programming of it. I mean, there's these are like jets on a runway. We'd love to have them all take off when they're ready to go, but so often the amount of money that we have available, lets us take three jets off the taxiway this year and three more the next year. So sometimes we have them designed and we have the permits, which takes a long time in some cases. And then we just have to wait to make sure that the cash flow and the money that we have available is there to do the project. I get frustrated with the length of time it takes to replace these projects, whether it's a bridge or, Route 1 or Route 95, pick your favorite route. I wish it could be done faster. I'd like it. I'm going to do my best to make it happen faster. $100 million would be better than not having it. $500 million would be better than that.
Understood, understood. And all right, I'm going to dive into one of these questions here that has a little bit more oomph to it, a little bit more detail. So just be ready for this one. This person says that they are an engineer and responsible for road maintenance at a municipal level. They believe that they're not seeing quite enough maintenance being done along state roads, which is leading to accelerated deterioration, unsafe conditions, unattractive roadways, et cetera. Basically, he realizes that PennDOT is lacking the adequate funding to perform a lot of this work and that they're also short-staffed, but he does see millions of dollars going towards some projects or other maintenance. He's just wondering about certain projects that are underfunded. How can we help PennDOT achieve adequate funding for these maintenance needs? How can municipalities work with PennDOT to address these maintenance issues? Yeah, they just basically want to see if there's any ways the municipalities and PennDOT can work together to address these issues.
I appreciate the engineer's question, and I'll remind the engineer and also everyone what I said earlier, and that we take 8 cents a gallon and give it to local governments for their liquid fuel allocation to help relieve the pressure on the municipal government's budget to do maintenance and repair work for the borough and township roads. So 8 cents a gallon is not nothing. And so that money we give to the communities first of all, the law dictates that we do it. But secondly, it helps preserve their network. What I would say is that if the preservation of the $500 million matters. I mean, it wasn't always $500 million. It was a few years back, it was $800 million, which was about 13 cents a gallon. That's what it was at its high watermark. And, that there's a level of insincere budgeting that predates Representative Sappey. She wasn't around for that exercise. But when the Commonwealth and PennDOT is responsible for $800 million to the state police, 13 cents a gallon siphoned off, prevents us from doing the maintenance at a level that we would prefer. And so, and I'm sure the engineer knows that, running a transportation bill and, rounding up the votes to raise the gasoline tax or raise their driver license registration fee, not the easiest assignment in the world in Harrisburg. It's hard to vote for such a thing. I did it when I was there, and I can assure you there are no pep rallies when you vote for Act 89. Thankfully, most people understood that we needed to have a functioning and efficient transportation network with roads and bridges that's maintained well. And finally, I'll remind the engineer that we have an SR network that most states do not have. And again, it adds to the responsibility that we have. So it's, I don't want to, woe is me, but the reality is we have 44,000 miles of roads and we have a motor license fund that supports local governments and the state police and a few other odds and ends.
Just to kind of follow up, this individual has a couple follow-up questions then as well. They're also talking about here basically that they realize that municipalities and PennDOT are encumbered with a lot of permitting requirements. Is there a path forward to work with maybe the legislators and the regulators to acknowledge this fact and work on maybe exemptions for maintenance or repair to get projects moving quicker?
We have to comply with the law. So whether it's federal law or state law, Representative Sappey doesn't have the ability to change federal law. Could state law be changed? Yes, but in so many ways, the state law is dependent on federal law as well when it comes to, say, for example, stream encroachments or wetland encroachments. We at PennDOT are doing our best to try and streamline the issuance of our permits to others. The engineer and others would know that we issue highway occupancy permits for driveways and for access to commercial properties. And that can be a torturous process sometimes. And we're trying to streamline that to make our permit issuance a little bit more convenient. But there are permits that you need from DEP. There are permits you need from the Fish and Boat Commission. There are permits you need from the Army Corps of Engineers. For the 420 bridge over Darby Creek today, there was a permit needed from the U.S. Coast Guard. And so it gets complicated when it comes to permits. Again, I don't want to hide behind, it takes so long and it's so expensive because of permits. But the reality is, if you want to drive a vehicle in the state and you're 16, you go get a permit and you have to go pass the test. And you wait 6 months with your permit before you can go for the test. So the permit process is frustrating again for me. I wish it were faster. And at least from PennDOT's perspective, and I know Governor Shapiro wants the agencies to all do this, to really take a run at trying to issue permits in a more efficient way. Not just to hand them out like candy. We have to make sure that the permits issued protects public safety, But we at PennDOT and all the other agencies are going to take a serious run at trying to make sure we issue permits quicker.
And our Representative Sappey, Secretary Carroll kind of touched on this. You don't issue these kind of things at the federal level, but is there anything that legislators can do to kind of help, expedite this permit process?
Well, I think the Secretary touched on that. It's, you know, we might have to, the governor's asking the agencies to expedite this, so they're going to be putting that in place through their own regulation. I think we have to see how that works. If that needs to be legislated, you know, I'm sure I would consider it. I think there are other folks in the House right now and possibly over in the Senate that are, you know, would legislate that. But I would like to see the agencies try to do it themselves before we put it in statute. I'm not sure that that's the way to
go. I would offer this, Representative and Dan as well, that, you know, the permits are there for a reason, and that is to protect public safety. Right. And whether it comes to extraction of coal or natural gas, or whether it's the installation of a road or a bridge, the goal of the permit is to make sure that it's done in a responsible and safe fashion for the public. And so, you know, if we just issued highway occupancy permits, there'd be driveways everywhere and there'd be accidents, and, you know, it could result in a fatality. And so, again, we're not going to deliver perfection, but the one of the base reasons for these permits is to make sure things are done in a safe way so the public is protected.
And if we change the timelines, and I'm not, you know, jump in here if you think I'm going in the wrong direction, but if we change the timelines or constrict them in any way statutorily, that makes that very inflexible. So you're giving, you know, an agency, this is your time frame, you know, for a permit to be applied for and processed. And that doesn't give you any flexibility whatsoever, given how many people are working in an agency. You know, right now, you wouldn't be able to do that. In a lot of our agencies, we don't have the people that we used to have.
And so much of the permit process requires a complete and thorough application to be submitted on the front end. You know, if you're, you know, to go back to the driver's license, if you're 16 years old and you make an application for a learner permit and you don't sign the form, or you don't have mom or dad sign the form, or a guardian sign the form, it's going to get rejected. And then when you fix it and resubmit it and we process it, you could say, well, my permit took months and months, and skip over the fact that you didn't sign the form in the first place. And so somebody might have gotten the permit in a month and you took 3 months. And why could this happen? Well, maybe that permit on the front end wasn't complete, or the fee wasn't there. So again, there's no perfection, and sometimes people make mistakes. Sometimes the mistakes on PennDOT or the other agencies. But again, Governor Shapiro, and I know Representative Sappey and so many others are talking about trying to make sure that the agencies do their part to issue these permits in a more efficient way.
Great, thank you. I'm seeing a note here that task forces have been formed within PennDOT to sort of review all of this and ideally improve the efficiency of the highway permitting process. So, you know, we know you're working on it, and I believe a lot of other agencies are as well. But, you know, it's my personal view here in the 158th that, you know, restricting this in statute could, you know, statute is hard to pass and it's really hard to repeal. So you really tie the hands of an agency when you do that. So if it's needed, you know, it's needed. But right now, I think if the governor's telling our agencies to act on this, I believe they're going to be able to do that. So
that's the goal.
Yeah, that's the goal.
All right, great. Well, we've got a question here from Carl from New Garden. What is the status on the Newark Road and Baltimore Pike intersection improvement?
So one of the things that I get to do as the Secretary of Transportation is to be a co-worker with really capable people all across the state. And Chester County happens to be in PennDOT District 6. Fran Haney from District 6 is on this meeting with all of us. And so I will introduce Fran to take a very localized question like that. I will apologize in advance that there are 67 counties and 2,700 municipalities, hard to keep track of every single project. And so there's really smart and capable people like Fran that can help address that one particular issue. So Fran, fire away.
Good evening, everybody, and very happy to be on here. And thank you, Secretary Carroll and Representative Sappey and Dan. There are also others on the call that can also respond to this question, but it's one of the things we took a look at today. We just issued design field view approval for that project literally yesterday. So that means it's through preliminary design and we'll soon be proceeding into final design. And that means basically the scope's been worked out. A lot of the right-of-way investigations, other things have been commenced and are moving along well. We're going to get that into final design now. And, you know, once again, as you noted earlier, that's a process that takes a little bit of time. But getting a project into final design is a major milestone. So we're pleased that that project is at that milestone, and we expect to continue to move it forward. I don't have an exact date on when the project will be let, but just know that significant progress has been made, and there's no delays that we're anticipating right now in that progress continuing to eventual letting and construction. Obviously, it's not going to happen this year, but we're going to continue to work through that. Others on the call, Tim or Chuck Davies, may be able to provide a date certain when that project could actually be let for construction. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Frank. Appreciate it.
And that was Tim that just came on.
Sorry, mm-hmm. I didn't know if you wanted me to continue on. Good evening. I'm Tim Stevenson. I'm one of our ADEs for design for project delivery in District 6. And I can tell you that the project's going to be in final design for probably about 2 years. We have some buildings that are going to need to get demolished and relocated, which will involve some displacements. Our right-of-way acquisition process that involves displacement takes some time because, relocating people and helping them move from one place to another, it's just a lengthy bit of time. Of course, we will still need to get permits from DEP, but in this instance, mostly related to stormwater management. So probably final design for about 2 years would be my guess before we get into construction.
Thank you so much, Tim and Fran, both for that, because that's an intersection that's pretty challenging, especially with we have an awful lot of, tractor trailer traffic in that end of the district with the mushroom industry and food distribution. So we're looking forward to that, and I'll keep you all apprised. But thanks for that update. Good question.
Well, this question comes from Blair in Upper Oxford Township. Given the behavior of drivers, especially in recent months after COVID, has PennDOT given any thought or action to adding or enhancing traffic calming measures as a way to deter speeding and reckless driving? If not, would it be more helpful to have this conversation with the PA State Police about this particular topic?
Probably both. At the end of the day, as we talked about earlier, the state police enforce the vehicle code, as do local police. But there are engineering and project modifications that could be made to help calm traffic and try and modify driver behaviors with the full knowledge that if somebody's going to be reckless, it's pretty hard to stop somebody who wants to be reckless. But there are, depending on the nature of the project, how many lanes the road, what the right-of-way looks like, what the elevate, what the grades are in terms of, downhill or uphill grade. There are a lot of variables with that question, but the general answer, yes, there are engineering steps that can be taken that would help calm traffic and modify driver behavior. But state enforcement and safe driving are probably as important.
And then we have another question here from George. George asks, as for new road projects, are you concerned at all about the pace of the design process and eventual implementation?
Yeah, we don't do a lot of new capacity projects. The program that we have attacks maintenance of our 44,000 miles and replacement and bridge replacement and so forth. So I guess what I would say is that the timing necessary for new construction in terms of permits and all the design work is lengthy. But when it comes to new capacity, financing is also a major problem. It's hard to justify a new three or four or two lane road when we have so many maintenance needs and bridges that are posted or closed in some cases. And so, you know, if the variables are right and a new capacity project advances, the financing is as much of a problem with new capacity as the design and the permits.
And just kind of going along here with permitting, why does District 6O take so long to review and work with local engineers on historic bridges? Our district has a lot of historic bridges in serious need of repair, and local projects get held up for what seems like years. Is PennDOT looking into streamlining that piece of the process? This is from Heather. Heather asks.
So the answer is yes. I mean, as I said, the governor asked for all the agencies, including PennDOT, to take a close, hard look at the process that we have for issuing every permit, and whether it's a highway occupancy permit, all the way down to a learner's permit for a 16-year-old. We are charged by the governor with finding ways to do that in a more efficient manner, but at the same time, making sure that we issue permits that protect the general public. So when it comes to historic structures, it's an added nuance. The history of Southeast PA adds that complexity that probably doesn't exist in some other regions of the state at the same level. And I know that adds to the frustration. And based on me reading between the lines with that question, I'm sure Heather would like things to move a lot faster. And I think all of us have that same attitude. What I would say is this: there's nobody at PennDOT District 6 or any of our districts that are slowing things down because it's fun to do that. They're not. The engineers want to make sure that we deliver projects that are safe and meet the needs of the traveling public. And so we want to make sure that we design and deliver a project that is safe and efficient. But at the same time, we have to make sure that we get the permits that we need from others. And so the historic nature of whether it's a property nearby or whether it's a bridge itself or whether there's a railroad involved, it adds complexities to the project that the average person would scratch their head and say, how could that be? I would simply say that, you know, as frustrating as that is, it is the world that we live in. And, you know, we're not given license to just ignore, the need for a permit for any of the above.
I think you touched on this a little bit before, and I think it kind of ties in here with permitting perhaps taking a little bit longer, but almost every industry, including PennDOT, seems to need more labor. What kind of initiatives, if any, are being started to recruit more talent?
A real challenge, and it's a real challenge in Southeast PA because of the cost of living in Southeast PA and the wage rate that a lot of employers have in Southeast PA. And PennDOT, in so many ways, has a pay structure that is consistent across the entire state, 67 counties. And so the wages and the salaries that we offer sometimes are not competitive. I can't say for certain, but I would bet that there have been message board signs in Southeast PA asking for diesel mechanics. We're desperate for diesel mechanics. We're desperate for operators that have a CDL with an air brake endorsement. We're desperate for engineers in some cases, especially in Southeast PA. So again, it's a reconciliation where the pay scale comes out of the general, out of the motor license fund for our employees, but for other state agencies, the general fund, you know, there's a general reluctance and, an aversion to tax increases on the income tax and the sales tax in Pennsylvania. And so, you know, legislators and the governor and people involved in government have to, be sensitive to the tax policy. And at the same time, try and deliver for people. It's tough to find the sweet spot there. And so, again, imperfect world, stating the obvious. But I think that somewhere along the way, we're going to have to increase the wages for the folks that work in these jobs, just to make sure that we have the manpower and the women power to get them done. And but that doesn't come cheap, and it doesn't come easily. But it is a problem. And I often say, Dan, that I'm probably the only secretary in the nation that has a CDL in his wallet. And that, if there's desperation in Chester County, I have a Class B with an air brake. I'll come down and push snow one of these days. I don't know if I'll do it well, and I'd be nervous about your mailbox if I were the one pushing the snow. But, I understand the need. And when you think about PennDOT, we have engineers that are unbelievably talented, but we also need the men and women that are in those trucks. And that do the maintenance and push the snow. And when it comes to somebody going to work on a Tuesday morning in January, the person in that truck is probably the most important person for that household that day. and we ought to treat them fairly.
Well, we already talked a little bit about traffic calming measures. Is there anything being done to help cyclists and pedestrians feel safer while using roadways?
That's also a real problem. The number of accidents and injuries and fatalities for pedestrians and bicyclists is up. More people are using those modes of transportation. I'm sensitive to that statistic. So again, we're back to reconciling available funds and with the projects that we're trying to do and incorporating measures that make sense. Captain Obvious here, we don't have sidewalks in every SR in the state. They're just not the wherewithal to do such a thing. Bike lanes, not the wherewithal to do such a thing for every one of our roads, but we try and incorporate them in projects where it makes sense, and we have the right-of-way, and we have the financing to be able to do it. It's a real challenge, but I'm sensitive to it. We're going to try and do a little bit better when it comes to pedestrians and bikes.
Yeah, and it looks like there's a little bit more improvements planned for roundabouts and things like that, bike-friendly resurfacing programs. How are those things coming along?
Can you repeat the question for me again?
Being improvements made to convert intersections to roundabouts, also some bike-friendly resurfacing programs. Could you talk a little bit about those?
Sure. So the roundabouts are a unique subject, and that always draws a question. And I'm not familiar with Chester County to the extent that you've had roundabouts installed. I'm going to, based on the question, the person asking the question has seen or driven a roundabout to the PennDOT is installed. The engineering says the roundabouts are safer. I believe that. And it also keeps traffic moving. There's not going to be perfection. There's still going to be fender benders from time to time. But the accidents that occur in roundabouts in generally are not 90-degree T-bone accidents. They're generally glancing blows. And so the engineering is sound when it comes to roundabouts. It also keeps traffic moving. Just having a stop sign or a two-way stop or a four-way stop, it's not the most efficient way to get from point A to point B. And so, but in so many ways, the installation of a roundabout gets you to the very prickly territory of change. And when you change, people sometimes have a difficult time accepting change. And I understand that. Change is hard. And you get used to a certain way. But the reality is that sometimes the engineering and the math says the change is the smart thing to do for the traveling public in terms of motorist safety, pedestrian bicycle safety, and also efficiency. And so when it comes to roundabouts, there'll probably be more tomorrow than there are today. The engineering dictates that we do that. Again, every project is engineered and designed in a way that, the considerations are made. And it's likely that some projects wouldn't result in a roundabout because of the unique circumstance of a particular project. But there'll be more roundabouts. The engineering is sound.
And we do have several roundabouts in the 158th, and they do help significantly. Our area has grown a lot in the last 10 years. We have a lot more folks living here. But obviously, we're sort of, stuck with the two-lane roads that we have. So when you're trying to get through Unionville on Route 82, when three schools are letting out, they're all right there on 82, it can get crazy. And so that roundabout has been a real godsend. And then we have a couple of others throughout the district, and they are helping. And I think people appreciate that they see that the traffic is moving. So as you say, nothing's perfect. There will be some fender benders, but they're not the serious accidents you get at the four-way stops.
And we inherit a alignment of these roads that existed before asphalt. I mean, some of these road alignments are the result of horse and buggy movements and right. Horses and pedestrians before that. So, if given a clean slate, no one would engineer, an intersection that has, five different convergence points and weird traffic movements that, they're sort of legacy roads that came to be before the advent of an automobile.
And I'd say 99% of the 158 fits that description. So anyway, thank you.
This one's a little bit more specific. This is Joe from East Marlboro. Is there any plan to resurface I hope I'm saying this right, Kaolin Road between Kennett Square and Route number 41?
Okay, Fran, that one's going to be in your bailiwick or for one of the members of our District 6 team.
I'm going to turn that over to Andy Furman, or one of the folks, Ray from maintenance. Can you weigh in on that, please?
Kaolin,
Kaolin Road.
Yes.
Kaolin. Kaolin Road, yeah.
Guys? Okay.
No worries.
We have a 5-year plan, and it's only a matter of Ray. You have this. Is it on our plan currently?
I'm sorry. It is currently. My camera's not working. It is on our 5-year plan. I believe it's slated for the year 2025 to be oil and chipped.
Okay.
Thank you, Ray.
Mm-hmm.
And again, there's sometimes follow-up. I would predict that the person asking that question would say, well, why oil and chip and why not just resurface the road? I'd ask that question if I were a resident there. And the answer is that if oil and chip gives us the ability to preserve the road in a cost-efficient manner. And it's a reflection of the challenges that we have with maintenance budgets versus need. And it costs a lot more to resurface the road, either to mill and fill or just to do an overlay. And so oil and chip gives us a cheaper alternative that preserves the road and lets us try and get to more miles of roadway in Chester County with Chester County's maintenance budget.
All right, great.
And if we preserve that $100 million and 40 or 50 million of it goes to maintenance and a portion of that 40 or 50 comes to Chester, and it will, then we'll be able to advance these projects in a little bit quicker manner. And if we do that with each of the $100 million increments, it will make a big difference. Hopefully it's less frequent oil and chipping and more frequent resurfacing. But again, we have to be sensitive to the budget that we have.
Can I jump in? Sorry, Dan, to jump in.
Yeah, absolutely. Please.
I do this to you every time we have a town hall. But I'm not sure that did we cover the how we do the 5 and 10 year plans, how roads, like we're not just paving a road because we're like, oops, that road needs paving. Did we cover that part yet? How we determine?
I don't think so. So there's what we call the TIP is the Transportation Improvement Program. And that would be the developed with the Delaware Valley Regional Planning Commission and the folks that prioritize and set in motion projects in the 5-county region. And then maintenance is a separate discussion and a different plan that PennDOT's county and district office folks manage in a way that recognizes the challenges of the road and the traffic volumes and so on. So two different tools there with respect to trying to sort out, which plans are going to take off next. But that from 10,000 feet, that's the answer.
Thank you so much, because I think a lot of folks may not be aware how we plan those things and schedule them out over time. Thank you.
And the planning partners come from all of the 5 counties, and they're dedicated volunteers that really do a challenging job, and that is to reconcile many needs with limited funds. I'm sure that they would like to have more projects added to the TIP sooner so that they go to letting sooner. But we have limitations. And I'll say it one last time, with that $100 million this year and $500 million in 5 years, it can make a difference. It will make a difference.
Great. And what is PennDOT doing currently to create more electric vehicle charging stations?
Okay, good news there. The Federal Transportation Bill, the BIL or the IIJA, whichever you prefer, appropriated money, all 50 states. Pennsylvania has received 2 years' worth of money that's spread out over 5 years, about $170 million. And we are in the receipt of about 250 applications for grants for charging stations. And this will be done in phases. The first group of charging stations will be on the interstate network and with distances no greater than 50 miles apart. And of course, in the more populated areas, they'll be a lot closer. In the rural parts of the state, but the interstate network in the rural part, there'll be some places where it'll be 50-mile increments. There are other highways that are included in the network besides the red, white, and blue interstates that everybody's familiar with. 322 and 15 and 30 and Route 1, I believe. but I don't know off the top of my head what segments of those roads. And so, you know, for the questioner, we could get a map for, of the entire state that shows the highways that are in the first wave of charging stations. Then the next year's appropriation from the federal government to the states, including Pennsylvania, will develop charging stations off the interstate that would get you to some of the other roads that are heavily traveled. There's no doubt the electric vehicle fleet is growing. There'll be more electric vehicles tomorrow than there are today and more the day after that. General Motors is talking about an all-electric vehicle fleet in the mid-2030s. And not to go back to money too much, but that brings with it a separate challenge for our motor license fund because electric vehicle owners don't pay a gasoline or a diesel tax. And the mechanism to collect a user fee from electric vehicle owners in Pennsylvania is antiquated, to say the least. No one contemplated this large universe of electric vehicles when the alternative fuel tax was implemented years ago, which is essentially a fee on electricity used to charge an electric vehicle. The law likely needs to be changed. I know that Representative Sappey and others in the House took a run at this last year to try and get electric vehicle users to pay something that approximates their fair share. But it's challenging. There's a lot of nuances there. I suspect that Representative Sappey will have to confront that legislative dilemma sometime in this two-year cycle. So electric vehicles are, whether it's charging stations or how we account for their use of our network. And, you know, when you think about a world 20, 30 years down the road, it's going to be a world with almost all electric vehicles and very few gas and diesel vehicles. And our motor license fund is populated by 75% of the money coming from gas and diesel taxes. And the Pennsylvania problem is going to be a problem that all 50 states have and the federal government. And there will have to be a discussion somewhere down the road of how do we fund the transportation network without the huge numbers of dollars that come from gas and diesel taxes. A big problem on the horizon.
Well, we do only have about 2 minutes here left. So I think I want to give us just one question here before we kind of say our goodbyes and everything and close out the night. This is more just for people in general, but this person's asking kind of specifically, when they had problems before, they would get in touch with District 6 manager Bob Kennedy. And since he's retired, they've had a hard time getting in touch with anyone who seems to have answers to their questions. They have some timely questions to ask. Who can they get in contact with? How do people connect with PennDOT on a personal level and dialogue with someone about something affecting their property, their land, or roads right around their land?
Fair question. Now, I'll let Fran direct that one. I'm not sure who Mr. Kennedy was. I'm going to guess maybe a county maintenance manager or just a maintenance manager in Chester County. And I'm certain that Mr. Kennedy has been replaced by somebody else whose name I do not know. So, Fran, who should the questioner ask? Yeah, who's the county maintenance manager for Chester? Let's just go right to that.
Right now, it is Ray Appler, who had commented on Kaolin Road. Ray is acting as the county maintenance manager. Andy Furman is the senior assistant district executive, my counterpart, for maintenance. We also have our wonderful legislative affairs liaisons, Desiree Chevs and Dawn Pimento. And all of our email addresses are available on our website. All of our phone numbers are available. We can provide them after this call. Certainly, we've provided them to the state representative. We are here. We are available. We're ready to respond to your concerns. We have the customer care system, which is also a means for anyone to submit a concern to PennDOT. And those concerns are required to be responded to in a timely manner. We get them all the time. It's routine for us, and we have lots of folks that work on those.
So I have great faith that the county maintenance managers have a really important job in the whole grand scheme of things when it comes to PennDOT. And the county maintenance manager's responsibility is significant. And I have great faith that Chester's county maintenance manager will do a good job, and he has a team of people that help him. So, Representative, you're welcome to hook up the person asking the question with the county folks, and we'll try to have a relationship as good as the questioner had with Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I've met with Ray. We have done some site visits, and this is something that I've done throughout my tenure, in office. We will come out and look at your problem that affects your property. You know, we've looked at collapsed trenches and full drains and, you know, look at trenches and drains that, you know, cross municipal lines. So we get public works folks involved in addition to our county maintenance from PennDOT. So, you know, if you think this is an issue that you're having difficulty getting attention from, please contact my office, because I am more than happy to go out and do the site visit at your property or in your neighborhood and talk about, you know, what might be able to happen to address that. I mean, we have stormwater issues. There are a lot of issues that we've, you know, worked with PennDOT over the last 5 years that I've been in office, and they've been super responsive. So I'm grateful to Chester County Maintenance and look forward to working with Mr. Epler. So you know how to find me, guys, 484-200-8264. And I can't thank you all enough for joining us this evening. Dan, thanks so much for fielding these questions. And Secretary, I can't thank you enough. We could talk all night. I know there are probably a million more questions, and we're going to, the ones that we didn't get to or ones that will be coming in after the fact, we will be sure to follow up with you folks. But thank you for taking time to speak with the constituents of the 158th. We greatly appreciate your time.
So let me add this at the end, that for the residents of this district, I want you to know that you have a wildly effective state representative. And she did not ask me to say this, and I'm volunteering this because I served in Harrisburg for 16 years. And there are 203 members of the House. God did not create all of them equal. And the reality is that you all are quite fortunate to have somebody that studies issues, understands the complexities and the nuance, and somebody that's really effective in advancing the interests that you have. Her challenge is significant, trying to get legislative coalescence around a particular policy is really hard, as we talked about earlier. The differences of the viewpoints of folks in this state is real. You don't have to go far from Chester County to find, I would offer that probably the Philadelphia County residents have a different way of looking at things than Chester County residents have a different way of looking at things from Luzerne County residents in Northeast PA. But Representative Sappey does a bang up job. You should all be thrilled to have her serve you. And I count her as a friend and a wonderful advocate for the people of Chester County.
Thank you so much. I definitely did not ask him to say that.
I know.
I really appreciate it.
I try and be honest, and I'm adding that bit of honesty at the end.
I know. I thank you very much. And we're really looking forward to looking to see what PennDOT does in the next couple of years. We're really glad you're there. Thank you.
I sure hope that I get down to Chester County for some groundbreakings, some ribbon cuttings, and yes, we improve the network that we have down in Chester County to make sure people can get from point A to point B efficiently, but also safely.
Absolutely. We'll make sure you're invited. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much, Representative.
Good night,
Dan, thank you. And to the residents, thanks for a wonderful night.
Thank you. Good night.
So long.